But we'll probably kick off if that's all right with everybody. I'm just turning my phone off, but I hope everybody else will as well. Just a few points of order, if you don't mind. Out of courtesy to other listeners and to Steve and to Jane, please do not move and walk around or go out during the pieces. If you do have to go out, if you're bursting for you know what, just wait for a gap in between the pieces. The running order's up here. There'll be quite a few pieces played. The actual duration we think is about 80 minutes, and with a bit of chat in between, it's probably going to take it up to about 90 minutes. So we expect to be finishing about 7:30, if that's okay. A few domestic points. That door, which is normally a fire exit, is currently locked. So your fire exits are the door that you came in through, and also through to the large room in the Brown Elephant. And if anybody does hear fire, just follow me because I'll be the first out. Welcome to visitors and to members. It's nice to see that there's a fair few visitors here today, which is great. This is the last in the 2015/2016 series of winter talks and events. And what a series we've had. It's been absolutely fantastic. We've had some really good talks, starting with Paul's talk on Northern Lights. Where is he? There he is. And we've gone, God, you know, too many to mention. We've gone through murders, round-the-world flights, histories of Lasham, a company startups, advanced aerodynamics, advanced human biology, and many, many others to tonight, which will be a pleasure. You wouldn't think it's going to be the spring is springing today, so thank you for turning out in this wonderful weather. Just before we go, we are actually working on next year's season already, and if anybody is bursting to do a talk or do an event, we would love to hear from them. There's a lot of homegrown talent at Lasham, so you know, please don't be shy in coming forwards. The rate of pay is terrible, by the way. So where am I? One of the things we're thinking about, actually, whilst we're here, is a straw poll. I'm thinking about organising another trip to Uxbridge. Anybody interested? Uxbridge and Curry afterwards. Yeah, that'd be good. Yeah, we'll see. We need a certain amount to make it work. Let's move on to the players. Jane needs no introduction to the members here, but for those who don't know her, she's been gliding since 1980. A very accomplished glider pilot, 3 diamonds, full cat instructor, tuggy, and no slouch across country. I'll see if I can keep up one day. And started guitar until aged 10 and was going to play professionally until you decided and got grade 8 and so many diplomas that there's not enough paper to write them all on. And then you gave up and came here. Whatever happened. Steve, an old mate of mine from way back when, proof that there is life outside gliding. We were mates in the early 80s, weren't we, and did an awful lot of drinking together and quite a lot of skiing and other sorts of mischief as well. We're part of the Union Mafia, which was a load of ex-BBC, well, currently ex-BBC Wallers, Royal BBC at the time. Steve started age 15 and then promptly stopped age 20. And comparatively recently, he's only started playing the guitar again. So that's a little bit about them. Just a quick word on the collection buckets. The charities tonight, we'd ask you to dig in your pockets and make a donation to go out. Charity tonight, thanks to Jane and thanks to Steve for nominating, will be the National Trust and the Gliding Heritage Centre. And finally, one word for the Gliding Heritage Centre. Gary Pullen set this room up like this, and a bit of appreciation to Gary as well. But meanwhile, to our player Steve.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Last minute panic trying to put microphones up, discovered the cables were duff. Usual. It's never happened to gliding, right?
We know a bit about duff cables and gliding.
I'm just going to ease myself into something to begin with and I'll start talking. The idea is this is both a talk and a performance, so feel free to ask questions. Hope it's interesting. And this is called Preludio de Adios. If you don't speak Spanish, that's the goodbye prelude, which probably ought to be the last thing on the set, but it settles my nerves, so there. settle down a bit. This next piece, so Johann Caspar Mertz, Austrian composer, 19th century, totally forgotten for about 80, 90 years. Nobody had heard of him, and then suddenly somebody found him on some dusty shelf in some library. It's interesting, dug it out, and lo and behold, it's pretty wonderful. He's written some really, well, did he write some amazing stuff. This is one of his softer pieces. It is very 19th century, as you'd expect, but I think it's rather pleasant to listen to. So this is called Lieber's Lied. Talk a little bit about some of the techniques on the guitar. Very interesting, varied instrument. Segovia called it a mini orchestra, which I think is a bit of an exaggeration, but I get what he was driving at. There's an amazing range of sounds and techniques you can employ. One of the things that fascinates me is to compare it to other instruments. So you can say that it's a little like a piano, that you can play more than one note at a time. But unlike a piano, you can do vibrato, you can vary the tone, which makes it more like a violin. Of course, what it lacks for a violin point of view is to be able to sustain a note and to be able to change the character of the note as it goes on. Julian Bream will say on some of his YouTube videos that the sadness of a guitar note is it's already dying by the time you played it. So guitarists love a little bit of echo, a bit of reverb, to try and overcome that a bit, so the notes sustain just that bit longer, because that means they can blend into each other more nicely. So one of the techniques to try and get over this problem of the notes dying away is this technique called tremolo. And what this really involves is that it's a bit like drumming your fingers on a table. I'm sure you've all done that. If I play it slowly, you'll get the idea. So it's basically the thumb is picking out bass notes, and the fingers are playing one string at a time. So I'll play a little slowly. So I'm going to play you two pieces that involve this technique, both Spanish. First one written by Francisco Tárrega, circa about 1890. Second one by Joaquín Rodrigo, who did that guitar concerto thing that I'm sure you've all heard on Classic FM. Somewhat different in character, but both Spanish. Francisco Tárrega played a very famous guitar maker's guitars. Almost all modern guitars are based on a template made by a guy called Torres in the 1880s or thereabouts. And basically it's this classic shape, but the dimensions are very structured. It's very specific measurements. And the bracing inside it. Now you understand that this piece of wood on the front is incredibly thin. And that all the tension of the strings is held in this piece of wood. So it could collapse very easily. And in fact, if your string breaks suddenly, it can crack the top. So sudden changes of pressure are very bad for it. Well, to stop it cracking and bending normally, there's a system of bracing inside. And Torres came up with this idea of fan bracing, so that the braces radiate out from the sound hole. And that technique's barely changed in the following 100, 120, 130 years. Except now there are some modern guitars which are double-topped and lattice-braced, and I hate them. They sound horrible sound, but people love them because they're kind of loud. They make a lot more noise, but who needs noise when you've got the tone? So, this is the first one by Francisco Tárrega. I'm sure you're will have heard this before. I'm going to stop because there's something rattling on here and it's putting me off. The way you tie strings hasn't really changed in 200 years, and it's unfortunately a little end can just touch the soundboard and rattle. That's what sort of happened there. Of course, the other bane of a guitarist's life is the strings move around, they change their tuning as they go. Okay, let's start again. Thank you. So the second of these tremolo pieces, it's not all tremolos, it's mixed in with some other techniques. It uses a technique called harmonics. Now harmonics basically, if you're a violin player you'll know what this is already, but basically if you hold the finger right in the middle of the string very lightly and pluck it, you get, so instead of, you get a kind of a slightly bell-like quality. And there's several places on the guitar where you can get this quality, so if a 7th fret does it, a bit harder on the 5th, but you can just about get a sound out of it. I know Jane's got a piece lined up that uses this technique quite a bit. The more advanced version of it is, well, you can't get every kind of note you might want just by playing these open string harmonics, so sometimes you have to stop the string. Like that, so you can actually, what I've done here basically is, let's do this G. If I touch the string in the middle now on the G, so it's basically halfway up the stopped string, and I pluck it with my 3rd finger, and I can get the same effect. So it would sound like that. See the difference? Okay, you might think it's fairly trivial, but the way it gets used in pieces tends to make a big difference. And the only other technique I'm going to show you, we do a lot of pizzicato like violin players do, so you get a bit of that. So you'll hear both those techniques in this next piece. Okay. Thank you.
Which I hope are tuneful. Hopefully you'll recognise some of them, and some of them are more serious classical pieces, which hopefully you'll appreciate and hopefully you'll have heard on the radio or other stations. So, here we go. The first piece I'm going to play is called Romance. I'm going to play a piece of music by Eric Satie. Eric was an interesting character. His music wasn't particularly loved during the time he was alive. And after his death in 1925, he actually died from cirrhosis of the liver due to drinking plenty, shall we say. And when his friends went into his apartment in Paris, they went in to try and sort it out. And they found a whole load of chaos and sheer squalor, basically. His apartment was full of, for some strange reason, many, many umbrellas. He had two grand pianos, one on top of the other. And the uppermost grand piano was being used to store letters and parcels. And when they went through everything, in his velvet suits, they found some pieces which he thought he'd lost. He'd composed some pieces, and he thought he'd left them on a bus, for example. But some were found in his velvet suits, in his pockets, and also in this topmost piano. Amazing story. So we have some of his pieces nowadays, which is very good. This particular piece I'm going to play, you may not have heard it on guitar before, it's called Gymnopédie No. 1. So sit back and relax. So I'm going to play a piece now by Heitor Villa-Lobos. He was a Brazilian composer, and he wrote for a lot of different instruments. He wrote for the piano, the harp, the cello, the harmonica, and he also wrote for the guitar. But he never played the guitar, so he didn't quite understand how it all worked. So when he composed music, he had a diagram of the fretboard of the guitar in front of him, and he would look at the notes, where the notes could be played, and in particular chords. He would look to see where chords could be placed on the guitar fretboard. And a lot of his music has chords which then are played and then are moved up the fretboard. And as I play this next piece, you'll see some of the effect of this as I'm playing. He wrote five particular pieces. There were five preludes for the guitar, which are very famous. And I'm going to play Prelude No. 1.
Thank you.
Steve was referring to it, it contains harmonics in the middle.
Thank you.
play is called Sounds of Bells, and this also has harmonics in it, and the idea is that it sounds like a little bit like a peal of bells. One of the first things I'm going to be doing is tune my E string down to a D. Can't do that on a piano. So it gives it a different feel, different key, we're playing in key of D here, and it's a nice tuneful piece, so hopefully you shall enjoy this.
Yourselves.
Well, while Mike's doing that, I can start talking, I guess.
Okay, yeah.
Can anybody see a big difference between these two guitars? Really obvious difference.
Different colour.
Did you notice any difference in the sound at all?
Yeah.
Sound different. So what's the difference, do you think? Well, how do they compare?
Kind of mellower.
Mellower, yeah. So this is spruce on the front. This is the traditional material that's been used for guitars forever. Also used for violins and everything, all those other instruments from way back. Most of it comes from the Italian Alps, so Stradivarius would have used the same materials from those same hills. James is using cedar, and that's a much more recent innovation. And it's a softer tone, and it's obviously very much a question of taste. It's said that the cedar is better for playing baroque and music like that, but I don't believe it. I mean, Jane sounded just lovely, so take your pick. I'm going to play something in a bit. Sorry?
No pun intended, take the pick. Oh, sorry.
We don't use picks. We have these fingernails. Relatively recent innovation. So going back into the 19th century, the guitar was always played with just a straightforward finger with no nail on it, but somewhere along the line people realised that the nail was like a pick and you get some nice tones out of it. So the typical sound, sort of regular pluck is kind of like that, but if you, there's a thing called a rest stroke where you can, subtle difference, right? So use that for bringing out melodies and use the regular for everything else. That's a common technique. This is a piece called Tuning Up by Brahms. It's said that guitarists spend 80% of their time tuning up and 20% of the time out of tune. It's horribly true. I must have used that joke last year. These iPhone thingies, aren't they wonderful? And in between I can play Angry Birds as well. Are there any gliding apps on iPhones? Got to be, right? Don't tell me now, it's okay. So this is a song written by Minnie Riperton and Richard Rudolph, arranged by a Japanese guy whose name I certainly can't pronounce, Takauchi. This guy does a lot of classical arrangements of regular pieces, so this is a nice relaxing thing to get into. Some of you may remember it. Anybody, can anybody do like bird calls and stuff in the background? Do you remember the original? Just like chirping away? No, don't, whatever you do. If you feel inclined to sing along at a certain point. All right. Next one, also popular piece, little older, Moon River. How many of you remember it the first time round? Too many by the look of it. I don't, of course. Thank you. through my E string down there. We retune these strings quite a lot because you take advantage of a different bass note on the open string. So open string means I'm not actually having to use my left hand at all to play it. And that leaves me free to play more fingers further up the keyboard, fretboard. As well as changing the character of the piece anyway, but it's very commonly used. The drop down to D is by far the most usual down tuning, but you also get down to the next string up, can also go down a tone. And then if you're playing lute music, you often mess about with the third string. So a few variations there. I'm waffling away because I need to let the string settle down before I start playing. This one's written by Andrew York. Andrew York's part of the LA guitar quartet. American guy, written an awful lot of guitar music. Gets played a lot on Classic FM. John Williams plays a lot of it. It's all over the place. It's very, very accessible. As I hope you'll soon find out. Barrios. Bit of a sad story about Barrios. He was born in Paraguay, pretty much self-taught guitarist. Back then, they still had steel strings on a lot of the guitars, so the kind of music he was playing on steel string guitars isn't bear thinking about. He was sort of discovered by Segovia in the 1920s and promised riches and fame and travel to Europe, and then Segovia went back to Europe, and because he was so worried about this guy's ability, he actually slagged him off and made sure he never got to Europe and excluded him from. So Segovia was not a nice man. So Barrios languished in Paraguay where he was a national hero. He went completely mad, mad as a box of frogs. He started changing his name, started dressing as a Red Indian chief, and turning up to concerts. He was absolutely off the... But his music is incredible. This is one of the more accessible pieces. It's called Julia Florida. It's a barcarolle. So a barcarolle, if you're operatic, you probably know what a barcarolle is. It's sort of a Venetian boating song. So hopefully you can sort of hear the sloshing and the dipping of the gondola. Or maybe not. And tuning is forthcoming.
Excuse me a second.
Thank you.
tuned both of these strings. This piece being in A kind of works for it. This piece was written for the piano and voice originally. Granados was pretty prolific in the 19th century. A lot of his stuff translates quite nicely to guitar. So during his lifetime, it was actually translated across into guitar notation. The Maca de Goya, I don't know who's heard of this. Have you heard of Maca de Goya, anybody? Any art buffs here? Goya painted two portraits of the same woman, laid out on a chaise longue, one with clothes on, one without. So one completely in the buff, and this is supposed to be the first ever erotic piece of art in the history of the art, because before that, any nudes were basically to do with some kind of religious thing. Nude angels or stuff. Goodness knows why angels were nude, but they were. We won't go into that now.
There's one other thing about Granados. He was drowned when the Lusitania was...
That's right. He jumped in after his wife.
Yeah.
And everybody else in his section of the boat was saved.
Yeah.
It's rather sad. 2 points for that man. I'm probably overstretching myself playing this because I'm a bit nervous tonight, so this might not go altogether well, but I'm going to give it my best shot. Thank you.
Steve. Well done, mate.
Well done.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Tuning fork. I don't need a battery for that.
It's an eye fork.
As well. This one's made by Jose Rui Pedregoso, who is actually a student of a very famous guitar maker, Ramirez. So it's made in Spain. It is, in fact, it might sound slightly different, a little bit contrary to what Steve said, because it's what they call a concert guitar, and it's actually larger than your average guitar. So for my little fingers, it's actually quite a big reach on some of these notes. A couple of other points about guitars and pianos. A piano is a stringed instrument, actually, strangely enough, although you play it by hitting the keys. And each key on a piano is the same width. So one of the things they do, a lot of pianists you'll see do, is they play a lot of octaves, and they'll put their finger and thumb out like this, and they'll hit the octaves like this as they go up the piano keys. On a guitar, the fretboard is where you obviously play the notes, but you may notice from one particular area on the fretboard, the higher you go, you need to put your fingers closer together, because the frets are close together the higher up you go. So you don't have the ability to do what a pianist does. You have to hit the notes spot on first time every time. It isn't an easy instrument to play. So I've spent 10 years learning this particular beast. A couple of other points is, Steve mentioned the what we call tirando technique, which is where you pluck the strings, and the rest stroke, or appoyando, which is where your fingers rest against the next string down. It makes the note more forceful. And also, if you play with your fingers nearer the fretboard, you get quite a sweet sound. And if you play with your fingers nearer the bridge, same chord, same notes, get a much tinnier, sometimes louder sound. So it gives a variation, different tone to the actual music. The piece I'm going to play now is a piece which I decided to put this in because I was just simply talking to somebody last week. We were sat in the Lasham restaurant and we were talking about children's TV programmes and what we remembered as a child, and we were going through the whole works from Andy Pandy through to Fireman Sam, you know, and there's certain things that trigger your childhood. Well, this piece of music, or at least the beginning of it, is from a children's TV programme in the 1970s. I'm not going to tell you what the name of the programme is. I want to see if you can guess what it was. The music is called Andante in C, which gives nothing away at all. And it was just the first section, but this was actually played on this children's TV programme. If you can remember the name, you have to tell me who narrated it.
Oliver Postgate, wasn't
it? Oh, no.
Thank you.
Johnny Morris.
Do you remember? Johnny Morris?
Tales of Riverbank.
Tales of Riverbank. Hammy Hamster? Do you remember Hammy Hamster? All the live all the live creatures, you probably wouldn't be allowed to do that anymore.
Four by time.
So, sticking with the kind of film type of thing, I'm going to play a piece of music now. It was written by a chap called Stanley Meyer. He wrote over 60 pieces of film music, actually, but this particular one, for whatever reason, John Williams made it a major hit, really came to the forefront. In guitar terms, it's called Cavatina, and the film it was played at was The Deer Hunter.
But it was used before, actually, I'll be clever. It was actually first used for a film called The Walking Stick with Samantha Eggar, and was revived for
Man of Medal. This next piece of music, a have been written by a chap called Sagreras. I haven't come across any other pieces of music that I've listened to or seen written by this gentleman, although he did in fact write an awful lot of music for the guitar in a sort of guitar teaching method so you could teach yourself. His writings culminated really in this piece because it's actually a virtuosic piece, it's a virtuoso piece. So this could go one of two ways. We'll give it a bash and see how it goes. Fingers getting a bit sticky now. A lot of music for the piano, and there's a lot of pieces which have been transcribed for the classical guitar. This particular piece was transcribed by Andres Segovia, and it is called Asturias. It's got some loud chords in the middle, sorry for the people in the front row.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, round of applause. Just a few words. Next winter event season starts on Bonfire Night. Be there or be square. Please.